Hi, I'm Norman Wildberger. Today we're going to introduce chromogeometry, an exciting new development in planar geometry, which brings three separate geometries together into one unified whole, and shows that the usual geometry that we've been studying for 2,000 years is really only one third of a much bigger and richer picture. So our three geometries are called blue, red, and green. This is to parallel what the physicists use in particle physics in the theory of quarks and gluons. They have a theory called chromodynamics. Who knows, may end up being related to this in some fashion or another. Our blue geometry is the usual Euclidean one, with circles that look like real circles, with perpendicularity in the usual sense, and controlled by this quadratic form, x squared plus y squared, which determines the notion of quadrants, which is the fundamental concept. The other two geometries are the red and green ones that we've been talking about in the last few videos here. The red geometry is controlled by the quadrants x squared minus y squared. And the circles look like rectangular hyperbolas of this kind, or this kind, or the null circle, consists of those two null lines. Perpendicularity in the red sense has a different meaning. These two vectors are red perpendicular, so are those. And we can visualize that by saying that the null line translated there bisects those vectors in the usual sense. Similarly, this null line bisects those vectors in the usual sense. The green geometry is a twist to the red one. The quadratic form is 2xy. The circles become rectangular hyperbolas that look like this, or like this. Or the null circle is just the two chordate axes. And now the notion of perpendicularity is this one. These two vectors are perpendicular because they are reflections in each other, in the usual sense, in a coordinate axis line parallel. Same there. So these three geometries, one is Euclidean, the other two are non-Euclidean geometries. These three are going to fit together to form this new subject called chromogeometry. So there are going to be two general principles which guide us in our development of this subject. The first principle is that the three geometries are alike. Despite their obvious differences, they have many features in common. And the claim is that if we state theorems in the right way, namely using rational trigonometry, then the statements of the theorems in all three geometries are parallel. Now, there are going to be some exceptions to this, so it's not a universal rule, but it is a rule with very broad applicability, as we'll see. And it's a way of bringing all those thousands of results in Euclidean geometry into the relatively impoverished setting of relativistic geometry. Relativistic geometry has a lot of catching up to do before it gets anywhere near the development of Euclidean geometry, and chromogeometry is going to allow us to do that. The second broad principle is that the three geometries fit together. They are not just isolated, disconnected things. They actually fit together to form some kind of unified whole. And we're going to see that it's the interconnectedness and the way these three geometries interact which is really the source of the most interesting results. Now let's remind you of a few basic definitions and a few fundamental facts that start chromogeometry. If we have two points, A1 equals x1, y1, and A2 equals x2, y2, then the quadrants between these two points can be measured in three different ways. There's the blue quadrants, x2 minus x1 squared plus y2 minus y1 squared. That's the familiar Euclidean way of measuring quadrants. The red quadrants, x2 minus x1 squared minus y2 minus y1 squared. That's the way a relativistic quadrant looks like. And here's another relativistic quadrant, the green one, 2x2 minus x1, y2 minus y1. And we've seen this theorem here, which is a fundamental fact that connects these three notions of quadrances. Let's call it the colored quadrances theorem. It says that the blue quadrants squared equals the red quadrant squared plus the green quadrant squared for any two fixed points. Okay? So you have two fixed points, you measure the quadrants in three different ways. Those three different measurements are related by that fundamental equation. Now what about spreads between lines? Well, there's a kind of a corresponding theorem for those. Let's see what it looks like. So suppose we have two lines, L1, which in our notation is given by the three proportion A1 to B1 to C1, and another line L2 given by the proportion A2 to B2 to C2. And I remind you what those things mean. This line here is represented by the equation A1x plus B1y plus C1 equals 0. And similarly for that line. So we have two lines in the usual familiar Cartesian plane. Now, the spread between them. The spread is a number that we associate to those two lines. It replaces the notion of angle. If you stick with angles, chromogeometry is almost invisible. You don't see it, which is why people have not discovered this remarkable theory up till now. Angles also do not work very well in relativistic settings. You can try to force them to work, but it just doesn't really ring true. And the reason is because angles are not the right notion. The right notion is that of a spread. And here are the three spreads between these two lines. First, the familiar blue spread. It's this expression here. A1 B2 minus A2 B1 all squared divided by A1 squared plus B1 squared times A2 squared plus B2 squared. So it only depends on the first two numbers in each of the lines. And I remind you that that number is the same as the square of the sine of the corresponding angle. So it captures the same kind of information as an angle does, but there's no transcendental functions, and there's no waffling around about what the notion of an angle actually means. This is very simple and algebraic, and works over a general field. And has the advantage that there's obvious analogs in the red and green setting. So here's the red spread. Numerator term here is exactly the same as before. Now there's a minus sign, however. And the denominator changes a little bit. It's A1 squared minus B1 squared times A2 squared minus B2 squared. And that's in keeping with the fact that it's a red geometry. And the green spread, same numerator term. There's also a minus sign. And now the denominator changes quite a lot. It's 4A1B1 times A2B2. And here is the theorem that connects these three numbers. Let's call it the colored spreads theorem. It says that 1 over the blue spread plus 1 over the red spread plus 1 over the green spread equals 2. And here's the proof. It's basically a one-line consequence of this identity. The identity is that A1 squared plus B1 squared times A2 squared plus B2 squared minus A1 squared minus B1 squared times A2 squared minus B2 squared minus 4A1B1 A2B2. That, when you expand it all out, cancel terms, rearrange, you get 2A1B2 minus A2B1 squared. And so, if you divide both sides by this term right here, then this over that becomes 1 over the blue spread. This over that with the minus sign becomes plus 1 over the red spread. And this over that with that minus sign becomes plus 1 over the green spread. And on the right-hand side, we get 2. Okay, next time we are going to start talking about a triangle and the Euler lines, the three different colored Euler lines in a triangle. I hope you'll join me for that. I'm Norman Wildberger. Thanks for listening.